Thank you. Please stand and join in our response of song.
The Lord is my shepherd.
I shall not want.
He makes me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside the still waters.
He restores my soul.
He leads me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death,
I will fear no evil.
For thou art with me, thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of mine enemies.
You know me to my head recoil, and I have on your mouth as odor.
Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life.
And I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever.
Please be seated. We'll have you come forward here for the reading.
When great trees fall, rocks on distant hills shudder. Lions hunker down in tall grasses, and even elephants lumber after safety. When great trees fall in forests, small things recoil into silence, their senses eroded beyond fear. When great souls die, the air around us becomes light, rare, and sterile. We breathe briefly, our eyes briefly see with hurtful clarity, our memories suddenly sharpened, examines, gnaws on kind words unsaid, and promised walks never taken. Great souls die, and our reality bound to them takes leave of us. Our souls, now shrunk, wizened, our minds formed and informed by their radiance, fall away. We are not so much maddened as reduced to unutterable ignorance of dark, cold caves. And when great souls die, after a period, peace blooms, slowly, always irregularly. Space fills with a soothing electric vibration. Our senses, restored, never to be the same, whisper to us. They existed. They existed, and we can be. We can be and be better, for they existed.
Walk backwards for those who don't know the emu and kangaroo can't walk backwards. And this always forward compulsion was such an intuitive complement to his college rowing coach's premise of one step at a time, one stroke at a time. So he loved wearing the cap of my son rowed for the Australian national team, which bore these creatures on its crest. And he must have had some patriotic reservations in wearing the Australian national team coat, but he did it with pleasure anyway. He was a creator. Lifelong career in advertising attests to this. He would have loved to have heard an excerpt from his many Russian writers that he loved so much. For me, though, one David looms above all others. Beyond the gourmand, beyond the adventurer, the stoic, the progressor, and the creator he so clearly was. David was a noticer. He noticed everything around him. He paid attention, often quietly, privately, but always generously and wholeheartedly. David is the supreme attention giver in a world where most seek it for themselves. Whether it was the 24-year-old wide-eyed American in Europe or the adult man behind one of his fabled antique cameras, or the friend in front of the stove cooking a feast, or the father, the husband, the brother, sister, and son in the living room. He paid attention. He noticed. So I selected a passage today from Jan Morris, that other magnificent noticer of the human condition. The excerpt is from a book called The World, Life and Travels. The title, I think, is an apt evocation in itself for David, that wonderfully gentle, interesting, and virtuous man we all love. And I hope you hear his voice in this passage, as I so clearly did when I read it. As I get older, I realize more clearly than ever that to the ultimate question, what it's all about, there is not and never will be an answer. The truest and most brilliant brains down the centuries have fudged the issue. The best we can do, I think, I have come to think, is to ignore the conundrum as we move from one phase of life to another. In my mind, there can only be one commandment to help us cope. Be kind. This plain injunction embraces the highest teachings of all religions. Flexible enough to allow for free will and human frailty, it is at the core of it, solid as granite, firm as St. Peter's rock, mysterious as the black stone of the Kaaba, simple as Stonehenge, organic as the Buddha's tree, authoritative as any mosaic law. Be kind.
Thank you. one of his favorites. I chose this reading because David shared and lived with unconditional love. If I speak in the tongues of men or of angels, but do not have love, I am only a resounding gong or a clanging cymbal. If I have the gift of prophecy and can fathom all mysteries and all knowledge, and I have a faith that can move mountains, but do not have love, I am nothing. If I give all I possess to the poor and give over my body to hardship that I may boast, but do not have love, I gain nothing. Love is patient. Love is kind. It does not envy. It does not boast. It is not proud. It does not dishonor others. It is not self-seeking. It is not easily angered. It keeps no record of wrongs. Love does not delight in evil, but rejoices with the truth. It always protects, always trusts, always hopes, always perseveres. Love never fails. But where there are prophecies, they will cease. Where there are tongues, they will be stilled. Where there is knowledge, it will pass away. For we know in part, we prophesy in part. But when completeness comes, what is in part disappears. When I was a child, I talked like a child. I thought like a child. I reasoned like a child. When I became man, I put the ways of childhood behind me. For now we see only a reflection as in a mirror. Then we shall see face to face. Now I know in part, then I shall know fully, even as I am fully known. And now these three remain, faith, hope, and love. But the greatest of these is love.
In my Father's house there are many dwelling places. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again, and I will take you to myself, so that where I am, there you may also be. And you know the way to the place where I am going. And Thomas said to him, Lord, we do not know where you are going. How can we know the way? And Jesus said to him, I am the way, and the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. If you know me, you will know my Father also. From now on, you do know him and have seen him. This passage is part of Jesus' farewell to the disciples when he told them that he was going to die soon. The disciples could barely hear his words because they were so distraught. What would they do without him? How could they find him if they didn't know where he was going? He answers their anxiety and their fears. Let not your hearts be troubled. Trust in God. Difficult words for the disciples to hear, especially when they were at times disappointed and even angry, as well as anxious and fearful. They wanted more from him and with him. A mix of emotions all at once. Their confusion, understandable. What was happening to the one who becomes such an important part of their lives? What was going to happen? Do not worry, Jesus said. I will come to you to show you the way. For in my Father's realm, there are many dwelling places. I don't think this is just about an afterlife. Rather, I think it's about life, this life, the one we're in. We are not far apart, Jesus said, I will be with you. I will be with you as you journey with God and seek what is true. As you journey with one another, I will be with you as you celebrate life and find your purpose to fulfill. And we know that Jesus did come to them, and he did show them the way, the path they were to take in this life to fulfill what they had learned from him and through his teachings and his healing. They too were to teach and to heal, to bring a new perspective and understanding to the call they've been given. When someone you love dies, you may wonder, how will I go on? Who will I be now without that person? What am I supposed to do? And Jesus answers, do not let your hearts be troubled. Trust in God. Know that God is holding you close, is crying with you, is grieving with you. Trust that love will carry you. Give yourself time to integrate your loved one's death into your life. Grief is your friend, for it will take you to the depths and to the heights of your love for David, your father, your brother, your son, your friend, and brother in Christ. Changing you, making you more compassionate toward others, and perhaps seeing a new way of being and living in the world. Jesus offers a new vision to the disciples, one where death doesn't bring an end to the soul or to life itself. It simply changes form. A vision that calls them and calls us today to see with our hearts and our spirit an all-inclusive, expanded worldview of God's realm. A vision that says there are many dwelling places, visible and invisible, where our soul consciousness resides. Even in this life, one may get a glimpse of it, a taste. It is like experiencing a different culture, visiting foreign lands, hearing new languages being spoken, all of which expands one's awareness of what is and what is possible. There are many dwelling places in God's realm, says Jesus. And then he went to prepare a place for each of them. Now the disciples weren't comprehending what he was saying. They had plans for him that didn't involve his death. Yet he told them he had plans for them. It involved what he taught them, how to nurture the hungry, how to care for the sick, how to heal, to advocate for the least in society, calm another's fear, and comfort the brokenhearted. Eventually, it became clear to the disciples that their lives had a greater purpose. Like them, it may take time for us to comprehend it and live into it. God was with the disciples and is with us in this moment, all through the valleys and the mountaintops of our experiences as each lives out his or her life. Even in that confusing moment, even in his death and following Jesus, following what Jesus was teaching them, in the realm of God, all are connected to one another in some profound way that our language, that our limitations cannot express or contain. Some things are just larger than we can imagine or describe. We are never separated from the love of God, nor the ones that we love. There's always a connection. And in the short time that I've known David, he had a strong sense of purpose in his life, to give to others, to be it to assist those struggling to find their way on a church committee, to see their potential, or serving a meal to someone who was hungry, to share the joy of being alive. He led by example, confident in what people could be, what could be done together. So let us now hear from Larry Gilman about the life of David, what he has meant to him and others, about his journey through life, his heart, and his passions.
mess. But I love David. Deirdre told me if I said that, it would be enough. She was worried about me. Isn't she beautiful? Isn't she wonderful? She called me earlier in the week, and when I saw her name on the phone, you know, I knew that that was what it was about. Naturally, it was, well, I just wanted to give you an update on the plans and what's going on and everything else, but I knew she was worried about me. But I did love David, and it feels good to say. So this is going to be a little bit responsive, a little bit participative. So say it, because it feels wonderful.
I love David.
I love David. You know, in all the ways that it's meaningful, you know, and of the many gifts that he gave me, his last gift was this eulogy, you know, and in giving me this privilege, you know, I think he knew that it would allow me to get lost in thoughts of our times together and of him, which it did. You know, the last several weeks were really emotional, a lot of crying. I think I've cried more in the last few weeks and months than I have in my entire life. And it wasn't crying so much out of sadness, it was crying out of, there were joys and memories and just a feeling of, oh my God, I'm not going to be able to share the next thing, because that's really what our friendship was much about. You know, it was about, you know, family, this lovely family. That was one of his many gifts to me, this lovely family. It wasn't just David's family, it's my family. You know, you let me in. You know, my daughter came and stayed with Mr. and Mrs. Aureden for a week. You know, who does that? You know, oh, can we use the house on Martha's Vineyard? Sure, the keys on the mat, you know, come on in. You know, it was David's welcoming spirit was part of this family, and it was a true gift to me. You know, it changed my life. You know, it really made me better. I have a lovely family. And by the way, my mother said to make sure that you all know that she loved David too. You know, I have a lovely family, a loving family. But this has been the family that David gifted to me. And the Buells were such a wonderful addition. And he was just so thankful for everything that you guys gave him, especially you. But even the time, you know, to see someone battling through cancer and being thankful. He was thankful that when he went to Boston, you were there for him. He felt terrible for people at the hospital who traveled from far away and were there alone. You know, he wanted to reach out to them, because he had so much, you know, he was thankful. You know, isn't that wonderful? I mean, what a lovely, lovely person, you know. And one of the greatest gifts he gave me, as I thought about it, might not seem apparent at first, but so I can introduce myself as, hi, I'm Larry, David's friend, you know. But that wouldn't really do it, because you'd say, you're not Larry, you are
David's friend.
What did Dad call me, Sophia?
Big Larry.
Big Larry. Right? Big Larry. You know, where did that come from? You know, I got this mountain of a man calling me Big Larry. And he called me Big Larry for as long as I can remember. But it wasn't just Big Larry, it was every permutation of that. You know, he had a beautiful voice. What a wonderful voice, and it would be big, you know, big man, big this, big, you know, and it was just, and what I realized as I think about it, because it wasn't just him who called me that, you know, again, Andrew was there with us on the rowing team, you know, the Coach Bergman, a legend in the sport of rowing, which was so important to David, you know, called me Big Lair, we were among giants, and these were Olympic caliber rowers, you know, these were all big men, but for some reason. But what I realized as I thought about it is people called me Big Lair because I was with Big Dave. And Big Dave was big. In every way, not just physically. It was his presence. It was who he was. It was how he treated people. It was how, you know, Philip said it beautifully. He listened. And he didn't just listen. He listened thoughtfully. He didn't talk a lot. He used his ears, and when he talked, it was meaningful, it was thoughtful. You know, so he wasn't just big in stature. He was big in spirit, big in soul, big in every way. And somehow, you know, my being him putting his arm around me and bringing me in made me big too. So I was Big Larry. I mean, I'm not a small man, but you know what I mean, you know. And it was interesting as, you know, Deirdre welcomed me and my family, my lovely wife Jean, my daughters Kim and Alex, into their home around Labor Day. And it was wonderful to spend that time with David, to have that time with David. You know, Deirdre gave him to me for a week, you know, a year ago, and it was a wonderful week. And I know it was hard, it was so hard to kind of let him go when things were so tenuous, but it was so wonderful to have that time together. And then a few weeks ago, to come, like many of you did, you know, Kevin and Janet, just unbelievable, and Julia, to be with David in the end, and again to see that even, and don't take the baby out, because he would love this, but, you know, even in the end, you know, to see how generous of spirit he was to allow us to help him, you know, in a quiet, very emotional conversation he and I had, you know, around Labor Day, he was most worried about being a burden on you guys. He didn't want to live like this because he didn't want to be a burden. You know, so I told him, I said, just let people help you. Let people help you. Let us be there for you. Let everybody be there for you. Don't try. He always wanted to do more. He always wanted to push himself. Let people help you, and he did. And it was so wonderful to be able to lift him up and carry him around. You know, and to be there with Deirdre for his last shower. You know, simple things, little things, just to be able to be there and hold him, and it was just, was truly a gift, you know, and I can't thank you enough. And, but as I left a couple of weeks ago, you know, I said to Deirdre, I said, you know, I'm gonna go, because Kevin and Janet had just come back with Alex. I said, I'm gonna go, you know, you're safe, everybody's here to help, you know, and there's really nothing left unsaid between David and I. We've had the time, you've given me the time to be with him, we've talked, we've not talked, we've cried, we've done all those things, and I'm gonna go, if you need me, you call. But otherwise, I'm gonna go. I said, nothing's been left unsaid. But then as I thought through what I might say today, I realized what was left unsaid was he didn't tell me what he wanted me to say. Because our friendship was unconditional. There was nothing I wouldn't do for your father. It's okay, don't worry about it. There was nothing I wouldn't do for your father, for your son, for your brother. There's nothing I wouldn't do for him. And there was nothing he wouldn't do for me. So, in a quiet moment, in a very emotional conversation, when he said, I want you to do the eulogy, I just said, of course. And then we went on with the conversation. And I went back, and as I was thinking about it, I was like, you know, he could have given me, you know, a clue. Give me a little help. But he didn't, which is good, because that was also part of the gift, because that forced me to really distill down all the thoughts. And what I know he would have wanted me to say was how much this family and friends meant to him. Because it was everything. And most importantly, to thank Deirdre. You know, I look for all these cliched quotes about love and about fulfillment, about couples, but you were the perfect partner for him in every way. And he loved you so completely and was so dedicated and devoted. And it was a beautiful thing to see. And he and I often gave each other a hard time. You know, I would tell him that he was hitting way out of his league when he got you, and then he would return the favor about my wife Jean, so we were in constant fun admiration of how lucky we were to have partners like you guys. And it was just To steal a line from Jack Nicholson, you made him a better man. If that were possible, he just was so happy with you. I don't know how else to put it. And Sophia and Alex, you were his life and everything to him. That's what we talked about. We didn't talk about books. You know, it was family, friends, and food. You know, not always in that order. There was drink back in the day, but you know, family, friends, and food. Fitness, rowing was big. I was going to share more stuff about rowing, but I'm not going to do that. So to really distill it down, as I thought about the message, that box is really something. As I thought about the message that I really think he wanted me to share was naturally to make sure Deirdre knew the depth of his love, which I'm sure she does. Naturally, so the family and friends knew how important you were to him, because that's what we shared. That's what we shared with each other. You know, but most importantly, I think he wanted me to, in public, even though I've said this privately, make sure you guys know, especially, and the family knows, especially, that the unconditional love that David and I had for each other extends to all of you. That if there's anything that you need, if there's anything that he might have done, if there's anything I can do, that I'm there for you, and my family's there for you. So I think at the end of the day, he didn't want me to get up here and say nice things about him. That was the last thing that he wanted. And I could stand here for an hour. I've only got 10 minutes. I think I probably used it up already. I could stand here for an hour and say nice things. We all could, because he was so wonderful, you know. But I think that's what he would have wanted me to say, to make sure you understood just how completely I'm devoted to you and this whole family, and how much it's meant to me to be a part of the family, and I look forward to continuing to be part of the family. I think that's what he would have wanted me to say. But I want to share a thought. First of all, wasn't he a handsome man? Wasn't he beautiful? I always stood taller when I was with David. Yeah, not because I was competing, but just because it felt good. You know, and when we were young and stupid and out there, it was so wonderful to be with him. But he asked a question towards the end, which I just wanted to share a thought from one of our friends. The outpouring of love and admiration from the rowing community, from the guys we rode with more than 30 years ago, was heartwarming. You know, it was just unbelievable to see how the guys pulled together and just expressed their support. The photograph that they sent that hung over his bed, you know, that's what he wanted hanging over his bed in his last days on earth. Just amazing how important that was to him and how beautiful it was. And I'll share some of the emails with you so you can see the comments. I was going to read some, but it's not necessary. Just admiration from people, many of whom hadn't seen him in many years. Just love and support and reverence and amazing stuff. But in the end, it seems very important to David to know what happens when the lights go out. Mm-hmm. Right? He kept saying that. He kept saying, everybody keeps coming and talking to me, and they're very kind. He said, but I just want to know what happens when the lights go out, you know? And so we found a wonderful book. We played an audiobook for him. My lovely wife, Jean, called and related a story of hers related to experiences where she feels her father has been watching over her. And, you know, I think he wanted to know what happens with the lights when the lights go out, because he wanted to know if he'd be able to continue watching over all of us, especially watching over you guys. And so a friend of ours, Scott Hamilton, he's one of the guys we rode with at Penn, had a terrible accident and a traumatic brain injury, which thankfully he's recovered from. But he shared his near-death experience in writing with me, and I shared it with Deirdre. And I just wanted to give you a little bit of insight into what Scott experienced, because it's lovely. He said, what was it like? There was no tunnel of bright light, and I wasn't floating above the hospital room, above my deep in coma body. The best way to describe it is to ask you to imagine when you hear a favorite piece of music being performed beautifully, and you close your eyes in rapture, that was how it felt. He said, there are many things pure reason can explain and many things it can't, but I'm also quite certain that life goes on and that we will be reunited with our family and best friends who have died and who will. You know, and I'm going to go with this, you know. I'm going to go with this, and I'm going to go with the story we heard, and I'm going to go with the story that Gene related, and I believe that in the beauty that we're all going to experience going forward in life, we're going to see David. I believe he's going to be watching over you, especially, and us. And that gives me comfort. I love David with all my heart. And I'm so honored to be here with you to share that.
Thank you, Larry. This poem is a kind of amen to the end of Big Lair's remembrance, his wonderful remembrance, after which really there is nothing more to be said. He goes free of the earth, the sun of his last day sets clear in the sweetness of his liberty. The earth recovers from his dying, the hallow of his life remaining in all his death leaves. Radiances know him, grown lighter the life of the hill that holds his peace. He's hidden among all that is and cannot be lost. He is hidden among all that is. He cannot be lost.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Reverend Matthew Binkowitz, and I am the chaplain at Hospice. And each and every time we are called to a home to offer our services for a family, those families believe we will teach them something. In reality, it is always the family that teaches us something. This family was no exception. Deirdre, Alexander, Sophia, his mother, his sisters and brothers, and all of you here demonstrated the greatest gift you could give anyone, your presence. You were there for him. Perhaps it was in the quiet moment of the evening or a pause in a life review session. Each of you here today gave David the greatest gift, so that when he left this life, much like the photo that hung above his bed, the Lord raised his arm in victory. It was beautiful. And so it was just a few weeks ago that the hospice team was called in to help, and all of them send you their deepest sympathies. And it is the first time we most likely met, although I was in Moscow in the summer of 1998, dressed like this, and they may or may not have seen me. So we could have crossed paths back then. It is a great honor to be here. I believe that David's friend captured the essence of David in the word love. And the prayer I'm going to chant is the Our Father, which is an expression of God's love.
Отче наш, иже єси на небесе, да святиться ім'я Твоє, да прийде царство. Да будет воля Твоя, яко на небеси и на земле. Хлеб нас насущным дашь нам нес. И оставила долги наша, яко же и мы ослепляем должнику нам.
Brothers and sisters of all faith traditions, all who have participated in that wonderful thing that we call unconditional love.
May we celebrate now the life of David, his gifts and love to each of us. May there be many stories remembered and celebrated and a legacy embraced. And may his spirit continue to live in the hearts of all who knew him. Now, O God, we lift up David into your loving care, commending him to you, knowing that you are love come home. May the angels surround David and the saints welcome him in peace as he resides in your love forever and ever. Amen. Now to us the living, let us remember what Jesus said to his disciples, I will not leave you orphaned. God will send you the Holy Spirit to teach you everything and remind you all that I have said to you and said to you and shown you. Peace I leave you, my peace I give you. Do not let your hearts be troubled, and do not let them be afraid. I am going away, and I am coming to you. All I have done is to show my love for God. Rise then, let us be on our way, trusting in God, stirred by the Spirit, abounding in hope, growing in love, and seeking justice for all the downtrodden. Rise, let us go and be on our way into all that life brings us, reveals to us on this beautiful journey with mountaintops and valleys. Let us give God the glory. Amen.
Come along, please, come along.
Hold each other close. Go in peace. Amen.